Okay, so thank you for maybe we can lower a bit Okay, so we'll continue and I wanted to make two points before, just two slides before going to the SO general relativity. So I mentioned at the beginning of the talk that the fact that Virgo came online at the end of actually at the beginning of August 2017, and that allowed the first observation of binary black holes in with the three detectors. And I wanted to point out that an important consequence of Virgo joining the network was the improvement in the sky localization. And this is shown in this plot. So again, this is about this binary black hole that has been denoted gravitational wave 17, 08, 14. And so you can see from here, so if you have only two detectors, what you can actually determine is a ring in the sky with the triangulation, I mean, just with two detectors. And in fact, it's not completely a ring because you have more in a region like this, an anomalous like this, because in fact, you also use some information about the waveform amplitude and phase added to detectors, and that breaks in part the ring and allows to get, as I said, this region here. This would be the region in the sky where the source would be if only the two LIGO detectors were operating. With the Virgo detector, we could go from almost 1200 square degrees, which is this region, to 60 square degrees, which is actually either the green or the gray region. The difference between the gray and the green region is just a different pipeline was used to localize in the sky. The rapid localization, it's a little bit less accurate, but it's faster. And this actually was run soon after the event was discovered. But taking a little bit more time, one can improve the localization still a little bit. And this is done with another pipeline, which is more accurate, which gives this Bayesian localization. But the main point is that really with the addition of Virgo, one could dramatically improve the localization in the sky from here to here. And also a little bit also the distance, as you can see, that from this region here, the shape, we could go in the best case to the violet curve here. So this was very important. You will see in 10, 15 minutes when we will discuss the binary neutron star that this was essential for the binary neutron star to then be able to observe the optical counterpart, this reduction in the localization in the sky, because for binary black holes, we don't expect an electromagnetic counterpart, but otherwise, to have a very large region is very difficult to do the association because you have many other, the sky is quite active, so you can have many events that then you would confuse with an event which is really due to the binary merger. Okay, so I wanted to say this, and then the other thing I want to say is that because we are seeing many black holes, binary black hole mergers, and they are also quite bright, you can imagine that in a certain volume on the universe and also going to larger distance, there are many, many events. And these events form So all the waves would superimpose, and they would be present at the same time and would form what we call a stochastic background of gravitational waves. And using some information from astrophysics, one of the LIGO scientific collaboration paper has reported results about the stochastic background, which is generally indicated with a quantity that we call omega gravitational waves. It's a function of frequency, which you see predicted here. Actually, we can have a superposition of signal from binary black holes, which is in green, and from binary neutron star, also taking into account the discovery of the binary neutron star that we have, which is in red. And if you sum the two, you get something like the blue. Now, there is an uncertainty, which is represented by the gray region here. And what you see in black are estimation of the sensitivity of the LIGO detector, okay, for the second run, which already happened. The third run that will start this year in the fall, if we reach the sensitivity, will be somewhere here. And at design sensitivity in the next 3-4 years, LIGO will reach actually this sensitivity here. So we will be able in the future to actually observe the stochastic background of gravitational waves, as I said, due to signals that are emitted by many binary black holes or many binary neutron stars at different distances. Now, I don't want to go into the details of the calculation of omega. I just want to point out that to compute this spectrum, the stochastic spectrum of gravitational waves, you need to know the rates, how many of these events happen at a certain distance or a certain redshift, depending on the parameters, and also on the energy in gravitational waves. Actually, the derivative of the energy in gravitational wave per frequency, also depending on the parameters, and there is also some dependence on the cosmology, actually, omega matter, omega lambda, the redshift, etc. So this is also quite interesting for the future. Okay, so now let me go more to discuss some tests of general relativity that have been done until now. So first of all, one may have the question, given the tight constraints on general relativity that we have today, which come from the solar system, from binary pulsars that I discussed this morning, this test that we have of binaries that are composed of a neutron star, which we call pulsar, and a companion that can be a neutron star also. Why, gravitational waves can actually compete already with this test that we have? Well, if we plot, like in this figure here, the Newtonian potential versus the velocity divided by the speed of light, the solar system is actually probing general relativity in a regime that we call weak field and slow velocities. This is because if you compute the potential, Newtonian potential, the Earth, the Sun, etc., it's actually quite small. It's not like the one that you can have with binary black holes or binary or neutron star or black holes, which is more in this region of the parameter space. Also, V is actually in the solar system, if you think about the speed of the planets going around the Sun, this is more in the region between 10 to the minus 5, 10 to the minus 4. But as we have discussed at the beginning of the talk this morning, for example, black holes, so I show you a plot, going toward merger, the velocity almost reach, in fact, a fraction, 0.4, 0.5 of the speed of light. So we are actually in this region here of the parameter space, a region that we call highly dynamical and also strong field in terms of the potential. So it's really a new region that we are exploring. and we perhaps we might find no deviation from GR, but it's you know, worthwhile to do the observ- I mean to test to do this test of general relativity. So the first test I want to talk it's a kind of test that resembles, maybe some of you are aware of, the so-called post-parametrized Newtonian test, which is done in the solar system, PPM, you know, the PPM parameters. It's not the PPM parameters, but it's similar, and it goes in this way. So if you take the gravitational waveform, I didn't indicate here, you know, the usual IJ, U or polarization, just you know, I call it Fourier transform of the signal in frequency, HF, you can decompose it in an amplitude and in a phase. Now, forget a moment about the amplitude, because we are very sensitive to the phase. We measure, I told you, we basically match the signal with our templates, and what using signal processing or match filtering, we are mainly sensitive to the more sensitive to the phase than the amplitude. So let's focus on the phase. Now, the phase is a function of frequency, besides a constant term and the term that is linear in the frequency, which are not very important, can be actually decomposed or written as a post-Newtonian expansion. So you have an expansion with a certain power in the frequency, m is the total mass of the binary, with powers here that corresponds, this is the leading order term. In fact, this is an expansion in V over C, that then you can rewrite as an expansion in frequency. But originally it's an expansion in V over C or Gm over RC squared. But because everything is tied together, V over C can be rewritten in terms of the frequency. With some power, let's not. So it's not so important to pay attention to the power here, but just to say that this is the leading order term, we also call it Newtonian, and then 0.5 pn would be zero in GR. Actually, the first non-trivial correction, non-zero correction, start at 1 pn, then 1.5 pn, 2 pn, etc. And this is known in the case in which, for example, the two objects are non-spinning, up to 3.5 post-Newtonian order. Now, in general relativity, these coefficients take a certain value. They depend on the mass ratio, the binary, they can depend on the spin, but they have a fixed value in general relativity. Now, I took this table from a paper, it's actually a summary or review paper by Nico Yunes and Xavier Siemens. If you have some modified theories of general relativity, for example, a theory that perhaps some of you are familiar because it goes back to many years ago, is the so-called Jordan Fields Brans-Dicke theory. It's a scalar tensor theory. And in this theory, because of the components of the scalar field, you don't have only tensorial modes, you have also scalar modes. You can actually emit scalar radiation, not just gravitational tensorial radiation, but also scalar radiation. And this means that you have a new term, which has some dependence on the Brans-Dicke parameter, omega Brans-Dicke, a certain coefficient. This basically, eta, is the coefficient that I called in the previous slide, eta, is that dimensionless number, the reduced mass divided by the total mass, and it enters at a certain post-Newtonian order. In this formula, it would enter at minus 1 pn, because the scalar, if you have a scalar component, you have a dipole emission. You don't start, it's not the quadrupole that is the first non-trivial multiple moment that gives you know, radiation, gravitational radiation, but it will be the dipole. And so, if you have, if you are in a scalar tensor theory, you will have a new coefficient here, which depends on the Brans-Dicke parameter, with a certain power in frequency. But in a modified theory of GR, also some of these terms can be different. You don't have just, sometimes you have a new term at reading order, sometimes you correct also some of the terms that are already there in GR. Okay, so what was done in the LARGO Scientific Collaboration was to assume now that
besides varying the 12 or 15 parameters that I was discussing this morning, on which the waveform depends on the mass in the spin, the distance, the orientation, you allow this parameter to be not fixed to the GR value. So you do a vision analysis in which this parameter can change, and in particular you vary, you introduce a fractional variation with respect to the GR value. If it goes to zero, means that's the GR value, but you could find something different from zero. So we didn't find any deviation from GR, so it's consistent with GR. But in this plot, what is plotted are the upper bounds of the fractional variation of these parameters with respect to the GR value. So delta phi equal to zero will be the GR value. And as a function of the post-Newtonian order, for example, the first event, the second event, and the combination of the two events. So if you look, for example, at the leading order term here, this would tell you that the part above here is excluded now, and we can bound this parameter at the level of 10%. 10% seems large, but in fact this is, for the leading order term it's not the first time, because binary pools do put a constraint on the leading order term, but for the higher order correction, 0.5, 1 PN, is the first time that we bound these parameters. And in the future, as we will improve, we will have signals that are going to be stronger, and longer also, waveform waves that are from binary systems that have lower masses. We can even improve more these constraints. And I want to emphasize again that these parameters, they all describe physical effects. The tails that I described briefly before, they depend on spin-orbit couplings, spin-spin couplings, etc. Everything is encoded in these parameters, okay? So this is an important test. But this test, this expansion in PN, it's valid, if you want, in the in-spiral part of the signal before arriving to merger. One can add higher order terms, or in this case they are not really predicted by post-Newtonian theory, so you add the parameters in the so-called intermediate or merger part of the signal, which are here denoted like the beta parameters and the alpha parameters, and you can also bound them, but this is more a phenomenological fit really, in the sense if you remember, I was talking about the calibration of the model, I was talking about building these phenomenological models in the frequency domain and tuning them, fitting them to numerical relativity. So in this case, what is done is that the beta and alpha parameter are just fitted to numerical relativity and they take a certain value, but just it's a fit, it doesn't, these parameters, they don't describe anything physically, and then you can allow this parameter to vary with respect to the GR value, and then you bound these parameters. And what these plots is showing, these sometimes are called the violin plot. It's basically delta P is like, the delta phi here, but the delta phi only was representing parameter during the in-spiral. So now I'm going also to have the beta and the alpha. So here you see the beta, and here you see the alpha. And this is basically the posterior distribution that made it reflect, you reflect it, you make it symmetric, so it creates like a violin. But it's the posterior distribution with the 90% credible regions, and the zero
because this is the fractional variation with respect to the GR value, the zero would be the GR value. So better the zero be in the 90% credible, which means the GR is not violated, and this is what you can see, that the zero is basically always within the 90% credible regions, but you know, you can have a certain spread around zero, and some of these parameters are more spread. It all depends how much you know the signal, if you are more sensitive to the inspiral or the merger or even the ring down. As you move at high frequency, these parameters may not be very well you know, constrained. But this is the best we can do today. If we want to do a parameterized test of general relativity, basically a null test, we use a waveform which is parameterized with respect to GR, and we try basically to bound the parameters. Another thing that you could do, which we have not done, is that you, for example, take your favorite theory, modified theory of GR, you build your full waveform, inspiral, merger, ring down, and then you basically build a template bank with that waveform model, and you try to match it against the data. That will be just working with a model, you know, with a specific modified theory. Here is more generic. You don't ask a particular theory of GR. You are just saying a modified GR in the waveform of GR, and I'm just looking whether GR is correct. If I find a deviation with this method, then the question is, what has caused the deviation? Then you need to have you know, a specific modified theory of GR in order to address that question.
Cassandra, sorry.
Yeah.
This means that you are just considering the phase.
Yes, we are just considering the phase.
And then you are considering also a part of polarization. It could be or not?
No, in this test,
just the
yes. In fact, I will come to this polarization. Do I come maybe later? Maybe I can answer to you actually this question. The polarization, it's so of course, if you are in a modified theory of GR, you might have not just the two polarization, but up to six actually polarizations. And also, for example, you could have that the wave is not just transverse, but it could be longitudinal, and you could have also so-called breathing modes. Now, if you have only two detectors, like the two LIGO, it's very difficult to measure the polarizations. But with Virgo, this will be possible. And in fact, there was a test done with the binary black hole that was detected also with Virgo, but was really a very preliminary test in which one assumes that the wave is only tensorial or only scalar, and just say something about you know, favoring one or the other. But in the future, with more detection of with Virgo, the measurement of the polarization may, you know, be possible, and that will be very interesting. But it's different from this test. Yeah. Okay. So another thing that we can do is to test Lorentz invariance and bounding the mass of the graviton. So how does it come? So, as I said at the beginning of my talk, predicted by general relativity, the gravitational waves move at the speed of light. And they are massless, okay? If you think about the gravitons that make a classical gravitational waves, they have zero mass. You could relax this assumption, even without having knowledge of a massive theory of gravity. You could be take more a phenomenological approach and say, okay, let's modify the dispersion relation. And instead of having the usual E square equal to P square C square that would be valid for a massless particle, we can add an extra term, which in the case
of, for example, in the standard case, if you want to add a mass to the graviton, there will be here a dependence on the mass. In fact, in the case in which you take just a graviton that has a mass different from zero, this would correspond to alpha equal to zero here, and you will have a term proportional to m squared and c to the power 4, you know, for this term. But you can be even more generic and put p to a certain power, okay? And this would mean that the group velocity divided by c is going to be modified, will depend on the energy. And this means that, for example, if a wave is produced in a GR theory or in a theory which has a modified dispersion relation, the waves would be different. The wave between two frequencies would have a different number of gravitational wave cycles. And so this is something that you can also test. And so what was done was to basically bound this parameter A, and in particular K, which is shown in this plot here as a function of the parameter alpha, that you can find in one of the LIGO scientific collaboration papers. And in the particular case in which alpha is equal to zero, in which you really have like an m squared term here, you can also think in terms of the Compton wavelengths, lambda g, which is related to mg through the usual relation where h is... yes. So you can actually put a bound on the mass of the graviton less than 7.7 10 to the minus 23 electron volt per c squared. Okay? So this is also something that is possible to do today with the discovery of gravitational waves. Okay, so let me move on with the next slide. Oops. Got blocked again. Okay. So now I wanted to actually go back to the comment I was just making. If you want to constrain or rule out modified theories of general relativity, so as I said, there are these two approaches. One is this parametrized way of parametrizing, you know, the waveform, as I was explaining to you. However, you could ask in this case, okay, but if I'm trying to look at deviation of GR by just parametrizing with respect to the GR, waveform, is this completely meaningful? Because you might expect that, in a theory, in a modified theory of GR, the deviation from GR could be non-perturbative, and not just that you can take account of them in a perturbative way. So this approach may not cover all possible deviation of GR. So it's very useful to use it, but it could be limited. The other approach is to specify a particular theory, modified theory of GR, for example, scalar tensor, Einstein-Ether theory, dynamical chain Simon, Einstein-Dilaton, Gauss-Bonnet theory, massive gravity theories, etc. But then, if you want to use a specified theory of GR, of non-GR, then you have to do all the work that I was explaining this morning, in which you have to really produce in spiral, merge, ring down, accurate waveform in this modified theory of GR. So you have to do analytical work, you have to do numerical relativity simulation, and you have to build a new template bank with 100,000 of templates that then you use to do Markov-Chain Monte Carlo analysis and use them. And until now, I should say, the only example that we have of numerical relativity simulation in non-GR theory are just a few. In fact, there are some in scalar tensor theory, but really some, I mean a few of them. Recently there have been some results, just one paper in dynamical chain Simon. So it's I mean, I'm sure in the future we will develop that more, but at the moment this is still a very green, you know, area of research. Another possibility is that what about if GR is still the correct theory of gravity, but perhaps what we are seeing, these compact objects, are not neutron stars, are not black holes, are some what we call exotic objects, or black hole and neutron star mimickers, like, for example, boson stars or grava stars. So a boson star is a star which is basically made of complex scalar fields that create you know, pressure that can counterbalance the gravitational force that would lead to the collapse. So are just models. Nobody knows if they can form astrophysically. So you write down an action with a scalar field and the potential. But they can be made quite compact, because as I was explaining this morning, in order to explain the detection that we had, you have to have stars that are very compact. They cannot be extended as normal stars. Grava stars are another solution that was proposed several years ago, in which you have basically a kind of the sitter, space-time, inside the star, in fact with a cosmological constant, are ad hoc solutions, and they can also describe objects that are quite compact. But again, whether they exist, how they form astrophysically, is not known. But they can also be, you can study, there have been actually some simulation of binary boson stars mergers. People have studied the quasi-normal modes, the ring down of those objects, but not extensively as, for example, black holes or neutron stars. Another question that you can ask is, how can we disprove that these objects were, for example, black holes? Because a smoking gun for a black hole is the presence of the horizon. But how can you actually how can you disprove the presence of the horizon? Because until now, the only thing that I show you is that we built binary black holes models with analytical relativity, numerical relativity. We have tested them against the data. They seem to be consistent with the data, but we have not proven directly that there is an horizon, okay? That the objects that have produced the gravitational wave have an horizon from the data directly. So I want to say something about that, because one way of actually proving the presence of the horizon is extracting more than one quasi-normal mode, and also to look at so-called echoes, and we have a slide on this. The last thing I wanted to say is that a remark I made at the beginning of the talk this morning about actually probing quantum gravity with these binary black hole mergers. Well, we expect quantum gravity may become active very close to the singularity of the black holes, because we expect that the singularity be solved by some theory of quantum gravity. But this happens perhaps at the Planck scale close to the singularity of the black hole. But for what I have shown you until now, we have with gravitational waves, we mainly probe the dynamics close to the radius or the horizon of the black hole, but we don't really access what is beyond the horizon of the black hole. So how we can access quantum gravity then? Well, there have been some suggestions, although at this stage still speculative, that perhaps in some there could be some quantum gravity effects that will produce a new physical scale that could be observable, because not happening at the Planck scale, but more at the radius or the horizon scale. But I'm not going to, you know, follow up these suggestions here. So I want to tell you about the quasi-normal modes, because this could be a way of probing really the nature of the black hole. Whether these black holes in nature are really the solution of, are the Kerr black holes, the solution from general relativity, or the Schwarzschild black holes. So in order to answer this question, we actually really need to extract more than one quasi-normal mode. So I told you the quasi-normal modes are are unique to the black holes in the sense they depend on the mass and the spin of the black hole, and if you can measure at least two of them, you can test the consistency. So you can test that they come from the same black hole having that mass and that spin. So what was done in the first paper on testing general relativity with the first detection of the binary black hole by LIGO has been the following. So if you take the waveform that was actually detected with the spiral merging down after some time after the merger, a Bayesian analysis was done looking for a damped sinusoid, okay? Damped sinusoid is a quasi-normal mode with a certain frequency and decay time. And what is shown in this plot are the posterior distribution obtained from the Bayesian analysis, more than one, because they depend on the time after the merger where this signal was matched against the data. 1 millisecond after the merger, 3 milliseconds, 5 milliseconds, 7 milliseconds. Now, the more you go away from the merger, the lower will be the signal-to-noise ratio, and so the larger will be the posterior distribution. So the measurement becomes not very accurate. But we could actually bound in some way the decay time and the frequency of the quasi-normal mode. And what you see here in black is actually the posterior distribution that comes from the full analysis in which you take the full waveform, in spiral merging down, you match against the data, and you get from the masses that you determine here what is the final mass and final spin of the black hole, and so the quasi-normal mode decay time and frequency, and you get this region here. And so we concluded that if you look for signal for damped sinusoid 3 milliseconds, 5 milliseconds after the merger, the signal is consistent with a quasi-normal mode. But this was an analysis with just one damped sinusoid. There was not enough signal-to-noise ratio that would allow, basically, to extract more than one mode. So basically the conclusion is that with the best signal that we had that allowed us to have the largest signal-to-noise ratio in the merger in down, which was the first detected signal by LIGO, we could only consistently measure one quasi-normal mode, but not more than one. So this test about the horizon, I mean the natural black hole, could not be done until now. And as I said, I want to emphasize again, to observe more than one quasi-normal mode is crucial to test the Noether theorem, the fact that the black hole only depend on mass and spin, and also the second law of black hole mechanics. Okay. And now the other thing, before I finish, it's about the echoes. So, in the geometry of a black hole like Schwarzschild, I told you this morning that we have a potential which peaks at the light ring. If there is no longer an horizon, then the potential is going to be modified. And so if you go in this direction where the horizon is, for example, you can build a wormhole, okay, which will have a shape, the potential will have a shape like this, You can also, for example, assume that there is no horizon, but there is a surface. And so in this case, the potential is going also to be modified. Now, if this potential is modified, then the quasi-normal modes that really depend on the nature of the horizon, the fact that there is an horizon, are going to be modified. And in fact, you can trap modes in this potential, in this barrier that you produce here. And now, if you look at the gravitational wave signal, instead, if you look at this plot, instead of having the red, the black, which will be, you know, after the merger, this will be the ring down part, instead of having the black hole case, you might have, for example, if you have a potential like this, like for a wormhole, you can trap modes. This is like a problem in quantum mechanics, in the same way, you know, that you can trap modes here, that then leak out from the potential, they go to infinity, and they create echoes, like you see here. So there is the merger, the ring down, and then after some time, you can have a new signal. Okay, they have been called echoes in the literature. So if we measure, one day we will be able, with a large signal-to-noise ratio, to perhaps see these echoes, that could be the signature of a potential close to the compact object, which is not the one of the geometry of Schwarzschild or Kerr. Okay? So this is also quite interesting to probing the nature of the compact object.
At what mass you are detecting, or could you detect this?
Well, for example, an analysis was done, although not by people in LIGO, using the public data, with the first event, which had a mass of 30 solar masses, the two black holes. The final black hole was around 68 solar masses. But, you know, they claimed that they have seen something with 2.5 sigmas. But, you know, basically this means you don't have enough signal-to-noise ratio really to see something. But the first event was observed by, you know, at the beginning of advanced LIGO. If the sensitivity was the same as advanced LIGO that we will reach in a few years, that same event would have had a signal-to-noise ratio of 70. So already, you know, this means that even the event that we have observed today, if we had the advanced sensitivity, you know, noise curve that we will reach in some years, we might do already quite, you know, better. And in the future, you know, in the next 10, 15 years, I'm sure, with a new generation of detector, this can be improved. Okay, so actually, because I want to start, I don't want to discuss this part, I want actually to start discussing the binary neutron star. So I finish here because I take some questions and maybe we have the break. I just want to emphasize, you know, that really there have been a lot of work that has allowed this theoretical work that has allowed to search and infer property, test GR, etc. And in the future there will be even more. I mean, this work is not finished, okay? There is still room of improvement to span the entire, you know, parameter space of masses and spin, include other effects, more faithful effect about spin precession, eccentricity. Until now, I mainly discuss, in fact, binary that move on a circular orbit, but there could be also binary system that move on an eccentric orbit. So there is still a lot of opportunities for, you know, using tools of theoretical physics to improve these results. Okay, so I stop here and take questions.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
I was wondering, in fact, this morning about the difference of, about having an horizon or not. And I was wondering, when you model the black hole, I guess it's basically a similarity. While if it's a neutron star, for instance, you will have a mass distribution. So, are they affecting you by the distribution the
Yeah, actually you will see it more in the second part this afternoon, but I had already a plot here, some point where it was a quite schematic plot, but the neutron star will be the signal from a neutron star. So if this is an example, if you take a black hole, neutron star that have the same mass, although we don't expect black holes to have a mass of neutron star, but in principle, then at low frequency or at, during the spiral, you don't see any difference because you are not really the two bodies. The waveform basically is the same. The two bodies are like point particles. But as you move toward the merger, then you start seeing differences. So the black here would, the blue here is the neutron star, in fact, because the neutron star will be tidally disrupted. It deforms. There is a new parameter that I will describe this after, in the second part, which is called the tidal deformability parameter that depends on the equation of state of neutron stars, which is not there for black holes. For black hole is zero. So that will be very interesting because it allows actually to see differences in the waveform due to matter.
Other questions? If not, thank you again.
Okay.
Let's go for the break.
Okay, posso iniziare?
Sì, vai, vai.
So I want to start now the second lecture that I think will be part now, and I think the last part will be tomorrow. Does it work better now?
Yes.
Okay. So I wanted to discuss the last observation by LIGO and Virgo. The binary neutron star observation. So this is the outline of the lecture. So as you will see, with the binary neutron star observation, we are really entering what we call multi-messenger astronomy, which is already allowing and will allow even more in the future to unveil the origin of the most energetic and extreme phenomena in our universe. And you will see the observation that we have done has allowed us actually to see signatures from the gamma to the radio. Also for this observation was crucial the modeling, the analytical and numerical. The analytical also to detect the signal, the combination of the two to interpret it and infer properties. And we are starting to have a look inside actually neutron stars, trying to understand what the equation neutron stars are. And quite interestingly also the event, because of the post-merger phenomena, this also has shed light on the production of the heavy elements, as we will see. And another important thing that happened with the observation of the binary neutron star is that for the first time, using just gravitational waves, we could have an independent observation of the Hubble parameter that I will describe also at the end. So let me go back to this plot that I showed you also this morning. So this was a three detector observation that happened just 17 days after Virgo came online. And as I said, was very large signal to noise ratio, 3000 cycles from 30 Hz, almost 1 minute. And what was also quite amazing is that just 2 seconds after the peak of the luminosity of the gravitational wave signal, the Fermi satellite reported, and then also Integral, the detection of a gamma reverse, of a short gamma reverse, which is actually what you see also in these panels here. So you see the Fermi GBM in the first two panels at different energies. And here the detection of the short GRB. And this is for the other satellite for Integral. Now, for a long time, binaries composed of neutron stars or neutron star black holes were actually predicted to be progenitors or the most likely progenitors of short gamma ray bursts. But this was just a theoretical prediction that was not proven until this discovery happened. And in particular, as was nicely summarized in this paper by Metzger and Berger, it was also predicted that as a consequence of the merger of two neutron stars, or a neutron star and black hole, a plethora of electromagnetic signals would be also observed. So let me go a moment through this cartoon. So after the merger of the two objects, neutron star and neutron star black hole, if there are the conditions to produce a jet as represented in this plot here, very relativistic jet, one would see first the gamma emission, which will be mainly beamed along the direction here of the axis. But then this would be followed by, so first of all, there will be possible optical after hours, days, radio emission, weeks and years. But this will be mainly beamed. On the other hand, as a consequence of the material reaching neutrons, after the merger of the two objects, also another kind of signal could be emitted. This is called an electromagnetic counterpart, which in the literature has been called also kilonova or macronova in some cases. This also could be produced and seen in the optical, and then later would also give rise to because of shock in the interstellar medium to radio emission. So this was all predicted, theoretical, etc. But as you will see, this is actually really what we saw, like in a textbook. Okay, so in fact, let me little bit elaborate again on this. So I want to focus a moment, in fact, about what was predicted would happen after the merger of the two neutron stars. So in this cartoon here, also taken by another paper, review paper by Brian Metzger, here you see what would happen for the signal and the dynamics of the two bodies. So the gravitational wave signal, the quiescence. We will see this also later, after the merger of a neutron star, there could be, depending on the equation of state and also the component, the mass of the component objects, the remnant can be a black hole or a neutron star. But in any case, one expects that because of the material that is ejected, the material is quite rich in neutrons. And people had speculated that so-called R processes, rapid neutron capture processes, would take place. These are really nucleosynthesis processes where you produce heavy elements. And in fact, there was the prediction that in order to produce elements heavier than iron, this would not just happen, for example, in supernovae. No, we expect the supernovae could produce heavy elements, but this could happen also in the merger of binary neutron stars. And this plot here is taken from a numerical relativity simulation of binary neutron stars for different equational states that are labeled here with these strange names here. And these are actually the masses of the two neutron stars. And this is the fraction, the mass fraction, depending on the atomic number of the element that can be produced. And in gray, you see the production, the mass fraction in the solar system. And this plot is just showing you that almost independently on the equation of state and varying a little bit depending on the mass of the neutron star, you could actually produce elements, heavy elements, with this atomic number as a consequence of the merger of two neutron stars. So this, you know, excited quite a lot of people working in nuclear physics because of working, you know, in trying to understand how heavy elements form in the universe, because another source for the formation of these heavy elements could have been a binary neutron star or neutron star black holes, which was not there many years ago. And now, if these ARP processes happen, so you have the rapid capture of neutrons, you produce very heavy elements that are radioactive, and after some time, quickly, these radioactive elements would decay, and in this process in which they decay, they would emit radiation, which is thermal radiation, and they will produce what is called a kilonova signal, or an optical counterpart, kilonova or macronova, that also will change in, you know, going from blue to red, etc. In few hours, actually ranging from, starting from maybe 10 hours after the merger. So this is quite important because these results would also shed light together with knowing, you know, from the signal, how the signal is modified during the tidal disruption, etc., would allow to actually test the phase diagram of quark matter, which has been conjectured to have you know, a certain possible transition between the hadron phase, the quark gluon plasma, etc. And I just want to emphasize that in this plot, this is the temperature and this is the chemical potential. Neutron stars will allow basically to probe this part of the phase diagrams. And of course, there are other experiments even today, for example, at CERN, the Large Ion Collider experiment, ALICE, which are probing other parts of the parameter space. For example, RHIC, RIC, and the LHC are probing this part of the parameter space. So this is quite interesting for people working actually in nuclear physics. Okay. So now let me tell you what happened. This is also an interesting story. The first hours in the LIGO team after the binary neutron star was detected. Because I show you actually the panel of the signal in the frequency time domain for the Livingstone, the Hanford detector, and then Virgo. Well, as you have read also from our papers, in the Livingstone detector, there was a huge, actually, glitch that happened at the time the signal was observed. So you can see the signal, actually, in the Hanford detector here, a little bit, you know, the track. And actually, you can see the signal in the Livingstone detector going up, but then there is this, actually, glitch. Now, if you want very quickly, so I told you 2 seconds after the peak of the luminosity of the gravitational wave signal, we got the alert from Fermi that the gamma ray burst was observed. It was very important very quickly to produce a sky map to give, basically send to the astronomer the sky localization, because if we wanted to see any other possible electromagnetic signal, including the kilonova, the possible optical counterpart, this would happen after maybe 10, 11 hours. And so we had to be quick, you know, and very also precise in localizing it very well. Now, there was this very big glitch that didn't allow to, you know, immediately actually produce an accurate map. And so a lot of work was done in the next hours after the detection to clean up the data, basically to to remove the glitch from the data, so that this is actually the result of the of the data after removing the glitch, so that in 5 hours the sky map was produced. And this was, as I said, very important to identify a possible counterpart. And in fact, let me show you this image here, which is also quite very interesting. So it's a very busy plot. So first of all, pay attention to this very large region here in blue, which is the region that was the sky localization identified only by Fermi and Integral. So as you can see, the satellite that have seen the short gamma ray burst couldn't actually localize very well the source in the sky. They are not supposed to do that. They don't have the technology to do that. So, and actually, as you see here, this is the Fermi GBM, and this is the Integral Fermi, together. Now, you can see here in green, if you use only the two LIGO detectors, you have this part, and you have this part, the ring I was talking about, earlier, in the afternoon. So the region is still quite large in the sky. So it's only through the combination of the LIGO and the Virgo that a region of only 24 square degrees, which is just amazing, is the best localization in the sky that we had with any other source, even with the binary black hole that was discovered 3 days before, the binary neutron star, which is this little region here, which is also displaced here. And you can see also at the localization, at the distance, how well the distance was obtained, was around actually 40 megaparsec. This was an event we didn't expect to see the first binary neutron star so close to us. And that actually explained why the signal to noise ratio was 32, which was also quite, quite large. And now these plots here are really beautiful. This is basically almost 11 hours after the peak of the luminosity in the gravitational wave that this satellite in the southern hemisphere, SWOPE, the collaboration of SWOPE, 10.9 hours after the merger, could identify, as you can see here, the optical counterpart. That then later, in the next few hours and day, was really understood to be the kilonova, macronova. And they could identify the galaxy, as you can see here, associated actually with the counterpart. This was also seen by other 5 facilities, including the DLT, which is also shown here, and you can see a little bit, the optical counterpart here. So this was already quite amazing, and I want to emphasize that this again happened only 11 hours and was very important to provide this sky localization as soon as possible, even circumventing the problem of the glitch that we had. So I want to go back a moment to this plot here. So this signal, as I said, was very long. And because it's very long, even if the signal to noise ratio was 32, we could detect the signal only using signal processing and match filtering. So this couldn't be observed with a minimal assumption and model search. And so we needed actually to develop waveforms. And again, here was very important the work, the analytical work, as I was saying this morning, because the signal lasted for a long time, so we needed here post-Newtonian templates. So the merger of the binary neutron star happens in the kilohertz, and it's the region in which the sensitivity of the instrument of LIGO is not very good. So where we accumulated the 32, signal to noise ratio of 32, is mainly from the inspiral part. It's the part that goes from 30 Hz to a few hundred Hz. And for that, we really need accurate post-Newtonian templates. And this is what was used. And in fact, you can see from here, so the last minute this is really the last, actually this is the last 30 or 25 seconds, but starting from 30 Hertz, you had 1 minute, and only starting from 0.07 seconds before the peak of the luminosity, a numerical relativity simulation can really describe the signal. It's very time consuming to produce this simulation. We cannot run for a very long time. So the numerical simulation only covers the last part here. So I want to go back again to this plot to show you again for the in-spiral. So this was very, very important to produce these post-Newtonian templates that encode information about spins. So neutron stars are supposed to have not very large spins, but still we have to have spins in our waveform to model them. So tail effects, and in a moment I will show you in fact the effect of the tides. Also, as you will see in a moment, the signal that comes from the merger of two neutron stars can be quite different from the one of the two black holes, and the post-merger signal in particular can be quite different. So to keep track of the phase for 3,000 cycles without losing much accuracy, we really need to have good templates, and we have to go beyond just Newtonian gravity, adding this post-Newtonian correction. And templates that were used for the search were actually now these post-Newtonian templates, the template bank that goes up to 4 solar masses, because for neutron star, as I said, the neutron star mass is expected not to go above 2-3 solar masses. So we search for binary neutron star signals in this region, using this region of the template bank. Around 50,000 post-Newtonian templates were employed for the search. And then templates of post-Newtonian theory, but also post-Newtonian theory, phenomenological and effective one-body waveform were used for running parameter estimation analysis, Bayesian analysis. So I want to show you actually a simulation that corresponds to the parameter of the binary neutron star that was observed. Just the last 0.07 seconds. The simulation now zoom in the dynamics of the two objects, of the two neutron stars. Now they merge, and for some time, even if they merge, they form actually, in this particular simulation, a so-called hypermassive neutron star, which lasts for some time. As you can see, there is a disk around material that is ejected, and then at the end, a black hole is formed, and then here, the simulation stops. But during this last process, starting from the merger, so we have first the gamma ray emission, and then, as I said, the optical was seen due to the ejected material, and then finally, even the radio. So this is, again, a snapshot of the main parts. So the gravitational wave emission that you can see here, the gamma ray and the X-ray that are produced from the jet which is launched by the remnant with the accretion disk, and then the kilonova. And the kilonova also changed, or the macronova, it changed in a few hours and days, going from optical to infrared. And then what is also amazing is that I think 2 weeks, I don't remember now the number of days, I think it was 11 days after the merger, we saw the X-ray emission, and a few days later also the radio emission was observed. So really the entire spectrum could be seen. And in fact, from the spectrum also, one could explain again, actually this was something that was reported even by many newspapers, people became quite interested to the production of the heavy elements, especially gold and platinum, I think. but anyway, so I think
now you know the this prediction that nucleosynthesis and the production of heavy elements that I was explaining before could happen also to mostly to the binary neutron star merger. It's really become very, you know, realistic in order, I mean, to produce the heavy elements in our universe more than from supernovae. And in this diagram here, what I'm explaining, these heavy elements, as you can see here, you know, dying low mass star, as you can see, or merging neutron stars are the ones that are in orange here, quite heavy elements. Okay, actually, what is the time? Because I don't want to...
Yeah.
How much time?
20 minutes.
20 minutes, okay, still I have some time then. So I took another few images from one of the papers that also came out after the discovery. The electromagnetic counterpart has been actually labeled SSS17A. And what you see here is basically the evolution of the light curves in their photometric bands, different photometric bands. That shows actually first a rapid rise and then decline, and they become redder with time. And actually this was predicted also in some of the papers, even before, you know, the discovery. And in fact, you can see here the images, I don't know if you can see very well, but this is again taken from this paper. You can see the August 17, 2017. This is basically half a day, 12 hours after the merger, and at the time, the first time the optical counterpart was seen, and it was in fact mainly blue. And perhaps here now you cannot see very well, but after 4.5 days after the merger, it became actually almost red, although you don't see it very well. Okay? So this is also quite interesting. Now, I want now to say a few things about what we have learned until now about the equation of state and also the masses of the two neutron stars of this binary that was discovered. So let me emphasize again, we think neutron stars have a mass between 1 and 3 solar masses. They are very compact. In fact, the radius ranges between 9 and 15 kilometers. And as I was saying this morning, the density, the core density, is larger than nuclear density, which is 10 to the 14 gram per centimeter cube. We really don't know what neutron stars are made of, especially, I mean, in the center, besides, you know, of course, having many neutrons. People have, for example, predicted that superfluidity could be present in the core of the neutron star. And in this plot here, taken from the paper by Antoniadis et al., actually, I think this is Nemores et al. Antoniadis et al. You see the mass as a function of the radius, so these are different equations of state for neutron star, many of them. The horizontal lines here represent the mass of the neutron star, which has been seen in some binary pulsars. So the binary pulsar has seen some neutron stars up to a mass of two solar masses. So some of this equation of state, which cannot go up to this value of the mass of neutron stars, are basically ruled out. But many equation of state still survive. Now, this equation of state differ the composition of the equation of state. They can go from mainly having proton, neutrons, electrons, and muons, containing also hyperons or strange quarks, okay? You can see that the radius, as I said, can vary between, here even 7 to 16 kilometers. And the difference between the equation of state is that So at the same density, you can have an equation of state that predict larger pressure, and if the pressure is larger, the neutron star can have a larger radius. And we say they are basically softer. So you can go to, from soft to stiff or hard equation of state. And this shows you the variety here. Now, in this plot here, this is the same I was showing in you know, in the plot before the break. You can see variation even when the binary, you know, with respect to a binary black hole which has the same masses. And this is better represented, I go back to that plot in a moment, in this actually plot here. This is taken from a review by Jocelyn Reed. So what you see here is the noise spectral density of okay, initial LIGO, advanced LIGO, there is even the third generation of detector for the future, okay, but focus on advanced LIGO, this noise curve here. And this is the Fourier transform of the signal in black for a black hole, where here you have the merger. And this black hole has the same mass of this example of a neutron star. So I think maybe it was 1.4 solar masses, the mass of the black hole, okay? As I said, black holes are not expected to have these masses, but this is just an example to show you to compare the two signals. And now what you see here, I was saying before, is that for part of the, as the signal sweeping band, there is not much difference between the black hole and the neutron stars, because they basically, the signal is like, depends only, can be described by a point-like object. But as you arrive around 400 Hz, then the tidal effects start to become important, and then during the merger, of course, there is a big difference. But now notice also that even if you take the noise curve of advanced LIGO, the noise curve starts rising above, let's say, 400, 500 Hz. And so the post-merger in this part of the signal is not very sensitive for advanced LIGO. And in fact, I will show you that at the end of the day, even if we look for actually signal in what would be the remnant after the two neutron stars merge, we could not shed light on that because we don't have a lot of signal to noise ratio actually in this last part of the signal. But what I wanted to emphasize is this dependence of the waveform on a new parameter, which is called the tidal deformability parameter. So this parameter measures the star's quadrupole, as I wrote here, the star's quadrupole deformation in response to the companion perturbed tidal field. So if this is the quadrupole moment of the star, of the neutron star, epsilon, ij, is the tidal field of the companion. So lambda is basically the ratio between the quadrupole moment and the tidal field. And it's a parameter that depends on equation of state. Now, I was having this plot because I was putting just in perspective the size of a neutron star, which, depending on the equation of state, you know, can be the larger radius or smaller radius. So this was just a map, you know, showing you Berlin, Potsdam, and where is the Max Planck Institute for Gravitational Physics. So this is the size of a black hole with the same masses as the mass of the neutron star, so it's a little bit more compact. And this is actually what I was saying before, that if you have, for example, an equation of state that for the same density has a larger pressure, then you have more repulsive nuclear force and the radius of the neutron star is larger. So the neutron star is more easily deformable, and this will be this case. But if for the same density the equational state is such that the pressure is smaller, then you have less repulsive nuclear forces and a less easily deformable neutron star, so it will have a smaller radius. And this is basically what this is showing. So this will be more deformable, easily deformable neutron star, which only contains muons and protons and neutrons and electrons. And this will be less deformable neutron star that also contains strange quarks. And so the radius is going to be actually smaller in this case. So, first of all, the work that I was describing this morning about binary black hole can be extended to binary neutron star. And in particular, the effective one-body formalism has been actually extended to include this tidal deformability parameter. And what you see here is the state of the art of this model with tidal effects, which is actually shown here in dashed orange, compared with, in black, a numerical relativity simulation during the last cycles of the evolution of two neutron stars. And what you see here are basically snapshots of the numerical simulation at different points, you know, at this time before merger. The merger happens here, you know, closer to merger, and this when the two neutron stars have basically merged. And in fact, what we do here is that we add a new parameter in the potential. You remember this plot that I showed you, this slide that I showed you this morning. In the effective one-body formalism, there is this potential. And now this potential is going to depend also on the tidal effects. And in fact, because of the presence of the tidal effects, this also I showed you this morning, this is the curve of the potential in Schwarzschild. Okay. This will be the position of the light ring as a function of R. So if you put only for a black hole, you have the red curve here, U, B, and R. If you put these tidal effects, the gravitational interaction becomes more attractive, and the final curve that you obtain is the green one when you have the tidal effects. Okay?
What is the form of this potential?
The form?
The form, the mathematical form.
Oh, is this equation here?
The tidal part.
The tidal part, I don't have it in this slide,
but it's just
a term that depends on lambda and some powers in M over R.
Ah.
So in fact, the tidal effects, they enter the first term. It's a 5pn term. So it's a 5pn term. You would say it's very small because it's 5pn. But the coefficient in front depends on this lambda parameter, and it makes that term larger. That's why, even if it is, you know, 5pn order, it's actually quite important for the neutron stars. But it's just a pn term, basically, at higher order. And it has been computed also at next to leading order, not just at 5pn, but it's known also at 6pn. Okay, now, using templates that are built putting together the effective one-body formalism or phenomenological waveform with the numerical relativity, and also using just positronium templates, adding tidal effects in the positronium templates, the LIGO scientific collaboration and Virgo have run Bayesian analysis to extract the masses of the two objects. Because, first of all, how do we know that this binary is composed of neutron stars? Because we saw the electromagnetic counterparts, so you would say, okay, if we think that the black holes cannot retain any accretion disk around, so that they don't emit any electromagnetic counterparts, these objects cannot be black holes, okay? But if you really want to shed light on being the neutron stars, you have to at least bound the masses and say the masses have to be in the range in which you know, we expect neutron star masses. And so I'm showing you now the posterior distributions
of the masses, M1, M2, the component masses of the binary, and for two different choices of the priors for the spin of the neutron stars. We don't know the spin of the neutron stars in the binary, you know, discovered by LIGO, but from astrophysics, we expect the fastest spinning neutron star has a dimensional spin 0.4. But the spin of the neutron star seen in binary pulsars is almost an order of magnitude smaller than that. So we had two analyses. One was going up to spin 0.05, which is the one in blue. And for this analysis, the Poisson distribution are in blue here. So they would say the masses range between 1.4 and 1.2, the 90% credible regions, and 1.3 and 1.6 for the other component, okay? And if we relax the assumption on the priors of the spin and we go up to 0.9, then because there is a coupling and a degeneracy between the mass ratio and the spin, then you can see that the Poisson distribution are even extended, they also extend to larger masses for the neutron stars. And so these are basically the only results just from the gravitational wave point of view, without taking into account the electromagnetic counterpart, for which we concluded that the two objects were neutron stars and not black holes. Now, of course, if you are completely agnostic, you could say, well, okay, but you know, maybe black holes could have a mass, up to 2.7 solar masses. I mean, it's not completely excluded, but of course, it's less likely. And so we still think that the system is composed of two neutron stars instead of a neutron star and a black hole. But from a gravitational point of view, this is really the only way that we have to conclude that we observed a binary neutron star. There is no other proof that we have for that. And by the way, this shape here is the shape of what we call the Chern mass, which is this parameter, the parameter I introduced at some point in my slide, the combination of the mass ratio and the total mass of the system, which is very well determined, as you can see here, 1.188 with this amazing small error in solar masses, because we had 3,000 gravitational wave cycles, and this parameter basically dominates the waveform over this amount of cycles, so we are very precise in determining this parameter. But we are certainly less precise in determining the component masses of the two objects. Now, I wanted just to say that the simulation that I showed you before, which was done, by the way, by Tim Dietrich at AI, was actually obtained with parameters that lie just in this region here, using an equation of state which allows for a hypermassive neutron star that forms after merger. Okay, now this is the plot I showed you before. So this morning, these are the two component masses that form the new object. Now, what is the new object? Just looking at the mass, might be a black hole, but there is an uncertainty in the mass, because the uncertainty comes from the fact that the total mass here, especially if you take into account, these spin priors here, can go up to above 3 solar masses. So, although, as I will show in a moment, it's more likely that it's a black hole if it has to form a jet and the jet has to give rise to the gamma ray emission, we cannot exclude that it is also that it might be a neutron star, the Redshift. It's certainly not seen anymore, like the emission from it. So we don't know even in the electromagnetic on the electromagnetic side. But it's more likely to be
a black hole than a neutron star, but again, we are not certain, completely certain. Now, about the equation of state, so the Marco Chia Monte Carlo Bayesian analysis allowed also us to put some bounds on the parameter lambda, which is the parameter, the tidal deformability parameter. So the first thing I want to say is that this parameter for a black hole is supposed to be zero. Now, as you can see here, this is lambda one, lambda two for the two component objects, for the two neutron stars. This is the 90% credible region, 50%, and what this line labels are the different actually equation of states. Okay, doesn't matter, you know. This actually, the only thing you have to know is that this equation of state here with respect to this, these are the one that correspond to more repulsive nuclear forces, so larger neutron stars, and as you go in this direction, these are going to be smaller radius, okay? But I want to highlight the fact that our Poisson distribution does not exclude the region around zero. So for example, this plot would not tell us that the two objects are neutron stars, because if this point here would have been excluded, then we would have concluded not from the masses, but from the measurement of lambda, that the two objects were neutron stars and not black holes. So we cannot do that, but as you can see, we can start saying that so-called stiffer equation of state, which are the ones that have larger radius, are actually disfavored. And in fact, depending on the equation of state that you use, if you consider, you go up to 90% credible region, I think if I remember correctly, this would say that the radius has to be smaller than, I think, 11, 12 kilometers for neutron star. But this result actually does depend on the equation of state, so one has to be careful. And this seems to be consistent with X-ray observations that come from binary that contains, in fact, neutron stars.
By the way, how much time I have?
5 minutes.
Okay, so I want now to talk about something else that we did. I will discuss actually the post-merger signal, etc., at the beginning of tomorrow. I think I might not go there. But I want to tell you what else we did with this observation, which was also quite beautiful. So, in fact, in 1986, Bernard Schultz wrote a paper, it was an excellent paper, in which he pointed out that compact object binaries are really standard candles, or we say standard sirens, because we associate sounds to gravitational waves, and we can use them to infer the Hubble constant. And the cosmology also extract, possibly in the future, other cosmological parameters. So what this means is that standard candles, what they are sources whose distance from the Earth can be inferred from their luminosity. And in fact, if you write the gravitational wave signal, as I said many times, it scales like 1 over the luminosity distance. Then there are some function that depends on the parameters of the binary. There is some dependence on the velocity square, and then some cosine of the phase of the gravitational wave. Now, doing the Bayesian analysis, we can actually extract the parameters, the masses, the spin, etc., and we can measure the distance. Okay? Now, if we measure the distance with a gravitational wave, and we exploit the identification of the host galaxy, which is what I showed you, in this slide before. So we could actually determine the galaxy, and actually, more precisely, the galaxy group to obtain the Hubble flow velocity. So we actually got VH. So this is the famous Hubble law.
the Hubble flow velocity is proportional to the distance through the Hubble constant. So then if we use basically this information from the optical counterpart and from the gravitational wave side we get the source distance, then we can get the Hubble constant. And this is actually the result of the posterior distribution of the Hubble constant in, as usual, kilometer to the minus 1 second per megaparsec as a function of, you know, H naught, so H as a function of H naught. And you see the posterior distribution. You see here, I think this was the 50 credible regions. Oh no, this is 1 sigma, I think, this is 2 sigma. And this is the value that we extracted. And what is interesting from this plot, well, first is the first time that using gravitational wave, which is a very independent way of getting the Hubble constant, we could get actually the Hubble constant. And also, if you see this, these two regions here, one is the result of the Hubble constant from the CMB, Planck, and the other one is from the supernova in orange. There is actually a tension between these two measurements, and at the moment we cannot actually value one or the other because we encompass both, because our uncertainty is larger. But in the future, as I will show you more tomorrow, where I will discuss future, you know, detectors, well, the sensitivity will improve and we can do this measurement with many, many sources. This will improve. But I wanted just to say that it's quite interesting this, because if you, so about, you know, this determination of the Hubble constant, so the determination of the Hubble constant has changed over the year, became, you know, improved the accuracy. So this is the measurement with the WMAP and the CMB over time. And, you know, today we are here. And this is actually the measurement with the supernova. As I said, there is at the moment a discrepancy. And it's important also to keep in mind that the measurement of the Hubble constant with the CMB and with the CMB and the supernova is actually looking at different times on in the evolution of the universe. Very large distance the CMB, smaller distance the supernova, and also with the gravitational waves. We are looking at different distance. So, I mean, this detection happened at 40 megaparsec, which is also different. So whether, you know, the discrepancy in the tension is due to the evolution, the cosmical evolution, that maybe, you know, may, we don't know at the moment, but I think it's very nice that we had this first detection measurement. And as I said, in the future, this uncertainty will certainly decrease, you know, over time, also with many detections. So I think I would stop here, take question, because so that tomorrow I can finish actually the this part of the binary neutron star and then move to the future. I think, in fact, I don't have any time, you know, so that I can take some question now.
Okay, thank you so much.
Questions, comments, also on the first part?
Everything, all day long.
Yeah.
Probably I should know, but I don't remember. So at the level of curiosity, well, I remember this plot where you have like the gamma ray burst emission, right? That you know more or less that is the maximum direction where you have more energy, more intensity, more flux, more everything, right? But then when you look at the numbers that we have on the paper, so the inclination is not very well determined, right? What's the reason of that? Because, I mean, from optical counterpart, it's difficult to pick this direction properly, or?
Okay, so first, actually, I had it in one of my slides, The isotropic energy emitted by the short gamma ray burst that was observed was actually, if I remember correctly, the number 10 to the 46 eggs, which is actually not a very high energy with respect to all the other short gamma ray bursts. And in fact, people have been suggesting that this was more an off-axis signal, and so was not seen on axis. And so from the gravitational wave side, we cannot, as you are saying, measure very well the inclination, and this happens because you know, we are not, I mean, because of the degeneracy between the parameters, and especially we don't measure very well the amplitude, which has the distance and the angles, you know, involved. So if it is more off axis, then the energy will be you know, smaller than if it is on axis. Now, in this measurement of the Hubble constant that I was showing, we are not injecting the information that would come if you assume off axis, then the measurement will actually change. I don't know if you are referring to this. So in the paper, we don't actually make any assumption about the inclination. That can come from the electromagnetic counterpart. And in fact, I want just to add one thing. I believe from the current measurement, we don't exclude that the emission, the binary was up to actually 36 degrees, you know, the inclination. So it's not actually necessarily on axis at all. So what was then your question? Maybe
I mean, from the gravitational wave side, I mean, it's clear that there is this degeneracy between the distance
and the inclination. I was asking about what comes from the telescopes, right? So I don't know why.
Yeah, and that's why. That's why I'm saying that from the telescope, if you put together the information, and also considering the fact that the energy that was not a very powerful event, then you can allow up to, I think, 36 degrees. Then, if you now use this information, you can refine the measurement of the Hubble constant.
Okay. Sandra, I have a question related with this in some sense. If you improve the number of the interferometers, you can get more information on the inclination, having improving the statistics in some sense or not.
If you include, you mean more than three?
Exactly.
I think you can. Yes, you can. I think improve the determination of the orientation of the binary with respect to the detectors. They also have to be, you know, maybe their geometry has to be. But actually, if I remember correctly, also you can, for example, if the binary, if the two objects are precessing, for example, you can also improve because you can disentangle, break correlations between these parameters if you have more, you know, precessional effects due to the spins that precess, etc. So you can improve this with more complicated dynamics.
Other questions?
Just a curiosity, what was the glitch due to, the glitch you mentioned?
Was just an instrumental glitch. You know, we have actually LIGO and Virgo, the Virgo people now left, there are many glitches that happen all the time in the instrument. They generally are, you know, people monitor and trying to measure them and then subtract, and we were a bit unlucky that, well, we were very lucky first of all to have observed this, but we were a bit unlucky that you know, this very big glitch happened at the time of the detection. But they are there all the time. The important thing is to just monitor them and understand, characterize, so that they can be subtracted.
Questions?
Yeah.
About the resulting mass from the usual star mergers.
Yeah.
You got something like 3 solar masses or a bit more.
For the total.
For the total.
Yeah, actually, I had it. This is more for tomorrow, where I will discuss what has been done for the post-merger. So the total mass is between, I didn't put here the errors, but 2.73 and 3.29 solar masses. So because the final object supposed to have a mass which is you know, close to the total mass, except for the mass that is ejected, it's emitted in gravitational waves, which is a 2%. So the final object, if it is a black hole, it's a very, very small black hole. Perhaps the smallest, the smallest mass black hole that has been ever, you know, observed. Although this is indirect observation because it comes from the merger. But yeah, if it is a black hole, it's very small. Do we know black holes of this mass in X-ray? Okay. Yeah, in fact, I think from this plot that, you know, this is the mass, and I think in violet, these are actually the masses. You cannot read, but these are from the X-ray binaries. Maybe not all of them, but some of them in violet. And we don't arrive here, in fact.
But it is interesting because if these objects are created by short gamma ray bursts, there are many short gamma ray bursts happening, so there should be a whole population of black holes of small sizes that we haven't detected.
Yeah,
otherwise.
That's true, but it's also true that, for what I understand, this was perhaps people think that this is even a new class of short gamma ray bursts. Because of, you know, not being very energetic, unless it's really of axis, etc. So we will see. I mean, as we will, Virgo Lago will come back online, and we will have more observation. We accumulate more statistics. Maybe we will see how many of these objects there are really.
According to this, in your opinion, it could change in some sense the story of the initial mass function by which you can form stars, since it seems that it is changing this kind of
situation. Of course there are, for what I understand talking with astronomy, a lot of uncertainty in the initial mass function, but this is more, you know, affecting besides the lower limit here, even the upper limit, because people had you know, problems in explaining how to build, to have these large black holes from collapse of stars. But I had a slide, I didn't show that before. You know, in order to produce a stellar mass black hole of 30-40 solar masses, you need 12 stars of 100 of solar masses that collapse. And you have to produce them, they have to exist in low metallicity environment because they are generally, they lose their mass through winds, and the only way, for what I understand, not to lose their mass is to basically have low metallicity that then, for which you have then weak winds, etc. So even the larger portion here in the mass, you know, axis is not well understood. Unless you form them, they come in, you know, globular cluster, they form through capture, and there you can grow the mass by just dynamical capture, etc., which is another story. It's not in binaries, in fields. And, so I think there are many things to be understood in astrophysics, I'm sure.
Other questions? Okay, if not, thanks. Alexander. Tomorrow at 10 here.